Good afternoon. It's my great pleasure to host this session today. Our first speaker is Vladas Sidorovicius from Institute National Mathematics Peering Application, IMPA, Brazil. He got a PhD at Moscow State University and Institute of Mathematics and Informatics, ILIAS. And he was a chair of ESF Excellence Network Random Geometry from 2010 to 2015. He was the Eisenberg Chair of Science Foundations at UC Berkeley and MSRI 2012. And his title for today's talk is Criticality and Phase Transmission, Five Favorite Theses. Please welcome the speakers.
Thank you very much for Scientific Committee organizer. So my previous title had five favorite pieces, so you will get only one today. And if you want to see order, it's in the paper. So all work which I considered for ICM relates to phase transitions and behavior at critical point, in particular continuity of phase transitions. And last 3 years faced kind of remarkable progress in this topic, which is nearly 100 years old. And especially I'm happy with progress in non-equilibrium systems, but today I chosen to talk about very classical problem, continuity of phase transition in statistical physics models in equilibrium. So, story begins, at the beginning of last century, when people looked at, especially physicists, at various forms of phase transition, liquid vapor, solid liquid, etc. And among these transitions, one particular transition took a very successful start. It was search, quest for ferromagnetic phase transition. So what means ferromagnetic phase transition, which actually opened beautiful chapter in probability theory? If you take bar of iron and put it in a magnetic field, it becomes a magnet. So it's very well known fact. But now what happens if you switch off magnetic field? And then people observed that if a piece of iron is very cold, it continues to be magnet, even though field is not present anymore. But if a piece of iron is hot, then it loses magnetization almost instantaneously, and it loses faster the hotter it is. So there was a quest by many, actually, theoretical physicists to create meaningful mathematical model. And here you see chronology, how it progressed. So in 1920, Wilhelm Lenz invented model which and gave to him his student, Ernst Ising, to study and to establish if it has phase transition. Unfortunately, somehow, Ising's thesis was dedicated to one-dimensional case, and there is no phase transition in one-dimensional case. So I will progressively tell the story. So next step was in 52, Cyril Dom decided to find a model which generalized Ising model. So, and he invented model he gave to his PhD student Potts, which became Potts model subsequently. Then 57, most of you know, Hammersley in joint paper with Brodmann introduced Bernoulli percolation. And finally in 69, Fortuyn and Castellan tried somehow unify all these three models in one, and there was a burst of FK random cluster model. So I'm not going to speak chronologically Ising, Potts, and percolation, so I'd rather start to explain what means continuity of phase transition, and what we mean for different models, and how we try to prove this thing. So first of all, first classification came from Ehrenfest, and Ehrenfest classified types of phase transition, depending if you are looking solid liquid, by first continuous parameter or some kind of derivative of some parameter, in this particular case thermodynamic free energy. And You see, immediately appeared first order phase transition or second order phase transition depending on continuity of derivative. So today physics doesn't use this kind of notion, but still first and second order got stick, and we still call first or second order phase transition. And in particular, second order phase transition means somehow the system goes continuously. And this model which people were searching as ferromagnetic phase transition belongs exactly to this class. So let me explain what is going on here on example of percolation. So that's more or less a scheme of my talk. So first I try to explain ideas on Bernoulli percolation and connectivity because it dominates all other ideas. So most of you already know this model. So you take your favorite graph, and behind this picture is Z2, but you can choose as general as you wish. And then each vertex or each bond, depending what you really want to model, it's open or closed with probability P independently of anything else. So on this picture you see Z2 bond, so you look every bond and it's open independently. So what you see in black, it's open, and if it's white and absent, means it's closed. So that's a typical configuration what you see in certain regime. But question is now, what can you say about connectivity? And with your naked eye, you cannot really see which vertex is connected to which vertex on the large scale. So bigger picture is more difficult to understand, provided parameter P is not pushed to extreme. Either it's almost zero, so you would see essentially no bond open, or if it's almost one, everything would be globally connected. Okay? So connectivity means that if vertex here connected to some other vertex, if you find open paths by open bonds. So here it's illustration, I'm not sure if you can see it clearly. So different colors means connected components. So every vertex which is in red can be reached from other vertex which is in red, but vertex in blue cannot be reached by vertex from red. So you see large connected components. In particular on picture on the left, you see that there is a crossing from bottom to top. Here you don't see neither left-right crossing, neither bottom-top. And this picture could be extended to infinite volume. You can easily draw imaginary landscape. And question is, do you have infinite cluster or you don't? Okay? And we know by now very well that for most nice graphs exists particular value which we call critical value. Okay? And if you choose to be open with parameters smaller than this value, you will not get infinite cluster in infinite volume. And if you larger, then infinite cluster exists almost surely. So there is a transition. Okay. So classical period of percolation theory established many beautiful theorems. In particular, most important theorem which governs life in subcritical phase says that if parameter P which you choose is below critical value, then you do not have infinite cluster, almost surely. Moreover, it determines size, exponential decay of size of the cluster. If you are subcritical, it's very difficult to be large, meaning that the chance that your vertex sits in an open cluster which has either diameter or volume of size n decays exponentially in n. Okay? So it was proven independently by Misha Menchikov in Moscow and Eisenman and Barsky in US in 1986. And similar theorem governs life above PC. So above PC we know that you have infinite cluster almost surely. I will tell it later, for most of nice graphs it's unique, okay, this infinite cluster. And then analogous theorem in supercritical regime tells if it's very difficult to be large but finite. So probability that you have cluster which is size n or volume n but is not infinite again decays exponentially fast with surface correction. So you need to pay price to encapsulate this cluster. So that more or less gives you universal picture below PC and above PC. So what happens at PC? And now continuity of phase transition in these terms would mean, and it was conjectured since the beginning, that at criticality you do not have infinite cluster. So it behaves as if subcritical, but in a very different manner. So First of all, decay is not going to be exponential, but going to be polynomial, so it's power law decay. However, in this direction, progress was very slow. First, Ted Harris, using some physicist arguments and essentially duality of planar lattice, showed that at 1/2, which is critical value we know today thanks to work of Harry Kester and 20 years after, it's a critical parameter, so he showed that at 1/2 you do not have infinite cluster. And then Harry Kester proved that 1/2 is actually is critical point by showing that PC is smaller or equal than 1/2. So it completed first stage. So as you see, it took to 94, then people could move a little bit forward, and essentially so first proof was by Takashi Hara and Gordon Slade using Lattice expansion, sort of inclusion-exclusion principle, but a nice thing was dimension so large was that it looks like as if you are on the tree, so they're kind of not nasty loops which spoils your beautiful calculation of probability of this inclusion-exclusion. So today actually this 19 by the same method of Lattice expansion was move to 15, and general wisdom says that these Lattice expansion techniques could bring us to dimension 11, however nobody really tried to do. So today the lowest dimension, it's not here on the slide, it's 15 or more. So next step was work by Beniamini, Lyons, Perez and Schramm. It's non-amenable Kelly graphs. So for this graphs was proven that phase transition is continuous. However, I have to stop here and explain a little bit more. So for most of nice graphs, when you look at phase transition, so you have critical value, below critical value, no infinite cluster, above critical value, there is infinite cluster, and at critical point, something happens, which I'm going to explain you during the talk. However, it was first work by Newman and Grimmett that they showed that something strange could happen. So when we look at infinite cluster, so it was a long story that people tried to prove its uniqueness. So you don't have coexistence of several infinite clusters. And first it was argument by actually physicists, which was rigorously proven by Newman and Schulman, that you cannot have any other number of finitely many clusters, only one. Either you have one, or maybe infinity. So they first excluded possibility to have two, three, any finite number of infinite clusters. So then finally, Eisenman, Kester, and Newman proved that for nice graphs like ZD, cluster is unique. However, exist graphs, for example, you can think tree times Z, so it's many layers of the tree, or non-amenable graphs, where you may have infinitely many infinite clusters. So what is happening, you start with small parameter p, all clusters are fine. Parameter is growing and reaches first critical value, after which suddenly emerge infinitely many infinite clusters. But you should see this on kind of very sparse graph, which can accommodate infinitely many infinite clusters. You keep increasing parameter p, and then infinitely many infinite clusters still remain. All of them are identical. I'm not going to stop at the question what means identical. So that you don't have sort of fat and thin clusters which somehow coexist. All clusters are statistically same. And then when you increase parameter, suddenly all these infinitely many infinite clusters merge in one unique cluster, and then it stays unique up to one. So you have double phase transition. So no infinite cluster, infinitely many infinite cluster, which merge at the end to unique infinite cluster. And it's an open problem posed by Odette Schramm. I guess it was back to 2006, that this transition happens if and only if your graph is non-amenable. So it's partially open. There is some progress in this question. So what these people proved for non-amenable Kelly graphs, the transition from no infinitely many cluster to infinitely many cluster at critical point has no infinite cluster. That's the theorem. So in many cases, we don't know what happens at the second transition point, where you infinitely many merge to unique infinite cluster. So at that period, so I'm talking around 85-95, there were many attempts to solve this problem in dimension 3 and more. meaning that to show that you have no infinite infinite cluster at criticality. So beautiful techniques were invented by Barsky and then used by Barsky, Grimmett and Newman, and finite size criteria used by Grimmett and Masren. And most likely I will have no time to comment on proofs. This is very powerful technique, this finite size criteria. It says that if you look at your system, you want to decide something in infinite volume, which is difficult to trace. But maybe you can discover property which you can look at finite box and show that something nice happens in finite box with probability close to one. Kind of nice event occurs with very, very large probability. Then using sort of box argument or one scale argument, you can show that such nice boxes percolate and therefore you would get something in infinite volume. That's standard philosophy in this area. So actually first progress now, I go to work with Hugo Dominique Copin and Bonsant Assiol. So people were stuck for a while in two dimension. All two dimensional techniques would break when you start to go to dimension three. So around 2008-2009, Benjamin and Schramm proposed to look at a slab, so several layers of two dimensional lattice. What can you say? And even you know, just take two layers connected, so you have Z2, and vertices connected by vertical bonds. And you apply the same technology. So by that time, something good happened. Grimmett and Masren published article which showed that PC on this graph, on slab, converges to PC of whole space if slab is getting thicker and thicker and thicker. So you have critical value which is separated from 0 and 1, such that on slab something interesting happened, and in particular you may have infinite cluster at values which are different of Z2. So how much can you extend these technologies to? And nothing really happened. So finally, using kind of approach from Grimmett and Masren, in 2012, Michael Dambron, Chuck Newman, and myself, we could understand what is going on in two-dimensional slab of thickness 2. It was ad hoc argument, very simple. It's just, you know, almost planar graph again. Still, it was difficult to show. And finally, theorem which I would like to report. So now this problem is solved for any thickness of slab. So S is slab, it's Z2 times 0, 1, k, so thickness k, any value of k. So if k is huge, you could feel naively that it's almost like Z3 for huge k. And then we know that PC of this graph for large values of k, it's almost PC of Z3, as close as you wish if you put k very large. So theorem, for any k, this transition is continuous. So indeed, for kind of non-trivial, non-planar graphs, we have this desired result. So unfortunately, it doesn't give you nice steps. So it still involves, and I will pronounce now some words for connoisseurs, kind of Rousseau-Seymour-Welsch philosophy. We don't use Rousseau-Seymour-Welsch estimates, like which are pivotal for two-dimensional cases. But still, idea of the proof is connecting paths, etc., heavily involves fact that k is finite, and essentially on large scale, this thick slab still feels to you as if it's planar graph, however it's not planar graph. So in our work we have several criteria which brings connection between slab and full space. And it's an open problem, remaining open problem, extend this result to whole Z3. Okay. So now moving on Z3, something better happened for using model. So actually this place where the whole story started. So remember 1920, Lenz introduces model which became probably most studied model in statistical mechanics, so Ising model. So you want to mimic this story which I told you about bar magnetization, iron bar magnetization. So take graph, here you have Z2, and to each vertex you associate now plus or minus spin. So in percolation, it was also, you could put the same value plus or minus, except interpretation is very different, because now I'm going to change measure. Measure is not going to be product measures in percolation, where you don't care what happens around, because everything is independent. Okay. So so as already mentioned, Lenz introduced easing to this model, which took name of the model. And remarkably, actually, easing left academia, and for most of his life, he even didn't know that there is model which is most studied model bearing his name in statistical physics. So most of you again know what I'm talking about. So you take graph, your favorite graph could be Z2, Z3, and to each vertex you associate plus minus spin. So you could think it's magnetic value. But now take energy. So how energy is defined? So first of all, I will put boundary conditions. So so this term means magnetization of given x, and H represents presence of magnetic field. If magnetic field absent, this term is out. You don't have. So now this term, exactly interaction between neighbors. So in this case, I'm choosing that x and y are nearest neighbor, but you can take interaction, your favorite one. And actually, changing interaction between sites could change drastically behavior of the model. So it could go from continuous phase transition to discontinuous, and it's kind of exhibits very rich behavior. In particular, I don't want to stop, but those who knows, if you take tails of these interactions very heavy, you can get Kosterlitz-Tauless effect, and things getting complicated even in one dimension. So, but if interaction is nearest neighbor or finite range, then that's classical result of easing, 1924, no phase transition. But now this, I'm taking J's, which are couplings between nearest neighbors, strictly positive, you can think it's one. And then this term, and being positive, it tells that when you will look at the measure, I still didn't define, it will somehow push configuration towards that spins, nearest spins, likes to be alike. They don't want to be in disagreement with each other. And finally, this term means how do you interact with the boundary. And boundary is going to be an issue for this story. So this Hamiltonian interaction, presence of magnetic field, which we may forget, and now measure. So configuration sigma, if you take in finite volume, so volume lambda is finite, boundary conditions are T, so you can think boundary conditions could be free. You don't put anything. So boundary point interacts only with the bulk in volume. But if you put pluses or minuses, means that this boundary affects you from outside. And here we have measure of configuration. It's e to the minus Hamiltonian. And everything is defined by what is called free energy or statistical sums in order to make probability measure. And here you can define a functional, it's an expectation of function, which is function of configuration, just sum over all possible configurations with this weights. Okay, so boundary conditions play important role, and so free boundary conditions, that it's zero, so it's completely neutral, it doesn't affect neighboring vertices to the boundary by any mean. You can take one, or you can take minus one. Okay, and question is how it affects measure. Here is picture. So I forgot to say there is something else which is very important, beta. This beta plays crucial role, and in, again, using physics terminology, it's inverse temperature. So if temperature is very high, beta is very small. Temperature is small, beta very high. Okay. So now you see picture exactly representing behavior of this measure. It's a typical sample at various beta. So if beta is very high, means temperature is very, very small, so system is frozen. And boundary conditions in all these six pictures are plus. Sorry, it's not focused apparently, but so what you see, boundary condition is all pluses, all black, right? And system typical sample, it's all black. So system at very low temperature wants to be aligned with boundary. When you start to decrease beta, something happens, but still you see boundary completely dominates. If you look in the middle of the box, you see that with large probability, if boundary was black, middle of the box also will be black, In other words, expected value of spin at origin is going to be biased towards boundary. So it keeps the same until you reach critical point, and then at critical point, this is a picture. You see boundary is all plus, but now minuses are fighting back pretty strongly. And question is, what happens here? Can you decide if origin here is plus or not plus or in mean value? And finally, when temperature beta goes to zero, temperature becomes hot, everything is mixed, and then it's classical result that expected value of spin at the origin is going to be zero. So here's another picture that's different, so just for you to have feeling what is going on. It's called Dobrushin boundary condition, so we have plus plus and minus minus, the same boundary condition here. Here again, beta is very large, temperature is very small, so this boundary effect essentially divides box into two competing fronts, and we know pretty well today what is this frontier is. And at criticality, again, you don't have any clear picture. So these results actually made the easing model to become one of canonical models of statistical mechanics, and here is formal expression what I'm looking for. So I'm looking at spin at the origin, at temperature beta with plus boundary conditions, okay, this notation. And then first classical result, which was by Rudolf Pyles, actually it gave all technology to us today, is that exists beta critical in dimension 2, very differently what Eisen proved in dimension 1, that there is no phase transition, that exists critical value of beta such that expected value will be zero if beta is smaller than beta critical. If temperature is hot, it mixes everything, so things are getting melted. But if beta is larger than beta critical, magnetization at origin will fill boundary. And this, of course, corresponds to infinite volume measure, so I omitted kind of formalism. So at the beginning, we were looking in finite volume lambda. It defines measure in this finite volume. You can take thermodynamical limits, and then you can define measure in infinite volume with plus boundary condition by taking one half type of limits. So, and this transition is transition in infinite volume. You don't see presence of finite volume here. So, so Pyles established existence of phase transition, and next step was to analyze what happens when beta goes to beta critical. And definition now, analogous to definition for percolation, that we say that transition is continuous if this magnetization at origin is vanishing if beta converges to beta critical. That was the big question, and then in dimension 2, Larsson Zager in 44, using exact solvability of the model, made transfer matrix kind of calculation. It was not rigorous, so it's exactly solvable, but non-rigorous. I think which actually his result pointed to the fact that in dimension 2, transition should be continuous, but still it was big hunt until Young in 1952 made step which finally allowed to conclude that transition dimension 2 is continuous. So today there is a very beautiful proof by Wendelin Berner in dimension 2 that is continuous, which doesn't use exact solvability of the model. And then next step was to understand what happens in higher dimension. So I don't know if you can see. So it took essentially from 44 to 86 to Eisenman and Fernandez to show that Ising model has continuous phase transition in dimension d bigger or equal than 4. So dimension 2 was Larsson-Zager, 44, 86 Eisenman and Fernandez, and they used very elaborated technology which came somehow from statistical mechanics, some ideas of Simon and Leib, finally, remaining dimension which was open until last year was dimension 3, and then theorem which completes now picture of Ising model in any dimension is by, again, Michael Eisenman and Ugo Dominil Copan and myself, that in ferromagnetic finite ray sheathing model on ZD with positive complex, you have continuous phase transition. So, most likely I will have no time to speak about proof. It uses random current representation and reflection positivity, so someone may ask why it doesn't go immediately to percolation. Unfortunately, we don't have such a rich set of correlation inequalities which we have for Ising model to push it for percolation. So it's still some progress and a happy end for Ising story, but still may keeps percolation in higher dimension as open question. Okay, so now let me continue, and the next step, 2D POTS model. So you remember on that picture, so it was next invention after Ising model, and it was 52. So Cyril Domb invents some generalization. So Ising model was built assigning to each vertex of your graph two values, plus or minus one. So very natural generalization, why don't we assign colors of any finite, from set of any finite value? So we get Q, and in fact, the way measure will be defined at the end, I can take actually Q being varying continuously, it doesn't need to be integer, it could be even smaller than one. But in that story, very different already scenario, it represents some kind of spanning tree, and it's different from Q being positive. So now think of Q being integer for this talk, and so Q state POTS model, it's exactly the same story. For each side of your graph, you assign value Q spin, and then you create Hamiltonian. So how Hamiltonian acts now? So energy is proportional to number of frustrated bonds. So you look at two nearest neighbors and check if they have the same value or not. And if they have the same value, you got one here, it's a Kronecker symbol here. If they have different values, zero. So more frustrated bonds you have, smaller this value is, it's going to have different energy at the end. So, and here is definition of measure, which again, G is graph, beta is temperature, and tau is boundary conditions. Now, since you have Q possibilities, you can put a boundary of monochromatic, for example, some particular value, and then you have interaction with the boundary in this sum. Okay. So again, this is free energy or statistical sum, and then you can go and define measure. And here happens very interesting story. So as soon as this model was born, it had very nice recipients in physics community, so a lot of people looked at it carefully, and in particular Baxter studied it again by non-rigorous means, and he, by again using some calculation, could see or indicated that now this model at criticality may have different behavior. So now I will say that it undergoes phase transition. So I have to introduce what means to have phase transition. So you have Q colors. So if your expected value at origin with boundary conditions being chosen monochromatic with color I, your expected value to have this I at origin is 1 over Q, means you have no feeling what is going outside. And if this value is changing, so if this presence of the boundary I affects this 1 over Q by some quantity, then means you, again, you feel boundary and you get phase transition. So this value actually was known for Q equals 2 and for Q bigger than 26 by other authors, so it's a kind of result which just Q equals 2 is a model, so it's 1944. And more recently, Lanate, Messager, and Ruiz proved it for Q large. But what was interesting in Baxter's calculation, that he indicated that transition will change for different values for Q. And in dimension 2, he predicted that for values Q 1, 2, 3, and 4, transition is going to be continuous. And starting from 5 and on, is going to be discontinuous. And in dimension bigger than 2, actually critical value, critical parameter Q where transition is continuous is 2. Okay, so it was open for pretty long time, so people knew discontinuity for large values of Q, but for small values of Q, only Ising model was solved for certain dimensions, and then this previous theorem of Eisenman and Hugo and myself, now this question is solved in all dimensions, so for Q is continuous. However, for dimension 2, it stayed open, so 1 and 2, again, it was percolation and Ising model we knew, but 3 and 4, it's open. So, here's another theorem, again, it's very recent result by Hugo Domenico Pan and Van Santasion. So for Q 2, 3, and 4, this transition is continuous. So so it shows that Baxter's prediction was correct. However, we couldn't complete it for Q bigger than 4. So it's a very interesting open problem. So it's not very easy to deal with Potts model. And all what we could get, it was based on our analysis of last invention in all these stories, 69, Fortuyn-Kastelein random cluster model. So this random cluster model somehow takes away this unpleasant configuration of colors, though Q will be present, and now it's more kind of easy to deal with FK models. I'm not saying it's simple, but it's at least more pleasant than Potts model, and how it is defined, and I will tell you connection between random cluster model and Potts. So you choose now, again, configuration is like in percolation or plus and minus one, okay? However, measure now is chosen according to this rule. So you take independently parameter P, and every edge is open or closed with parameter P, just like in percolation, okay? So then you choose your volume, take number of open edges, and it's p to the power of open edges, 1 minus p to the power of closed edges, but here is an extra term. It's a q to the power, q is exactly q from Potts model, to the number of clusters you have in your system. So you look and you have disconnected clusters, and you multiply by this term. Okay? So it's not completely trivial passage, it's actually even, I would say, very sophisticated Edward Sokol coupling, which links this model to Ising model or to Potts model. So, and then we are studying this model in dimension 2, and now it's, again, completely different technique from previous two theorems. Here we're actually profiting a lot from new technologies which have appeared in the last 10-12 years in planar. So this result is planar, it's dimension 2. Okay, so it uses Smirnov's fermionic observable and techniques which people developed studying conformal invariants of Ising model. So in dimension 2, so we prove theorem which says that these five properties are equivalent. We are not saying they are holding, we are showing they are equivalent. So first of all, it's a absence of infinite clusters at criticality. It's exactly first spirit of the first result I spoke for percolation, that a critical point, but now in FK picture, so it's a measure at criticality, but measured with this extra parameter Q. And we show that if Q is 2, 3, or 4, okay, for 2 it was known already, but 3 and 4, this is 0. And therefore, this, what we see here, implies validity of all these five properties, which gives you continuity of phase transition for Potts model as Baxter predicted for Q2, 3, and 4. So in some sense, results with Eisenman and this theorem essentially shows, exhausts predicted phase of continuum phase transition for Potts model. And just to finish, two open problems remain: to show discontinuity for Potts model for Q bigger than 4 in dimension 2, or for Q bigger than 2 in dimension bigger than 2. And of course, from the first theorem, it still remains open how to go from slab to 3D. And I stop here.
Any questions or comments? Okay, yeah,
as far as I understood, for the EC model, you couldn't do non-US neighbors, so that would be excluded.
So could you repeat?
If you modify the model, say, to non-US neighbors, you couldn't probably do it, because you're using this reflection positive.
Yeah, that's nearest neighbor. So reflection positivity for second tier is pivotal.
Yeah. Any more questions?
What prevents you to, once you deal with the bottom level with the FK cluster representation, what prevents you to use it for calculation?
This last theorem was in dimension 2. So yes. we use for propagation it's known anyway. So we cannot move to higher dimension.
What happens in Q equals 0 then for these parameters?
I don't know.
Any further questions? There are next question.